Okay, now I'm ready to start my analogous color project. I have my color wheel, my color palette mixes right up here. That little extra, I put a swatch of burnt sienna in some of the colors just to see what would happen if I toned them down a bit. That was just an experiment, but what I've done in my palette is I've mixed up my French ultramarine blue with my Windsor yellow, and I've mixed up my Windsor blue with my Windsor yellow. I found that the Windsor yellow mixes were giving me the deep colors that I was interested in. And now I'm working from a photograph. Typically, I like to work from life. So typically I would do this project outdoors, plein air, but for the sake of the demo, I'm working from a photo. That way I can have my video set up in the studio. So one thing I love is the way sunlight dances through the leaves in the evening as the sun's about to go down. So I noticed this outside my window quite frequently. And so what I did was I went ahead and I took a photo of exactly that. I looked up into the tree, and as the sun was shining through the leaves, I saw a perfect idea for this analogous color project. So as I start the project, I have a warm mix of the ultramarine blue and the Windsor yellow, and I'm going to start with that. I'm looking at the shadow areas of my leaves, and in those I'm just putting in those shadow areas. So with these leaf forms that are somewhat abstracted, it may begin to look like I'm doing some abstraction. I'm doing these abstract leaf patterns. I can go in later and layer over them. So right now I didn't even sketch in my drawing. You can sketch your drawing in. But the leaves are just tumbling down through the tree. And I'm just putting in the shadow, an indication of the shadow that some leaves are casting on other leaves. And then I'll go in later with my yellow green, a much warmer, more saturated yellow green color, to complete this leaf pattern. Now some of these colors haven't dried, so if I want a little bit of wet on wet blending, I can do that right here. If you pay attention to when your color is dry or when it's wet, as we move up into the tree. One thing that's really nice about this project is if you pick an organic shape like leaves or even some fruit shapes, you can use abstraction. You don't have to worry about something looking perfect and realistic. You can use some abstraction in your work. I'm going to start with just the big shapes. It's always good to start with your big shapes and then later come in with smaller shapes. So I'm looking at my photo, which I'll put up for you next to this video. I'm just looking at the big shapes. The big dark shadow shapes. I can see as it gets a little bit cooler as I move up and away toward the sky. direction of a branch going off the page. This is a really good exercise at just looking at abstract shapes, looking at leaves on a tree, because they are so organic. Mix up more of my Windsor yellow and ultramarine. I'm also referring to my palette to see what color do I want to create. I have a nice branch and leaf shape coming in here. A nice shape study. I'm using my large flat brush for the big shapes, and then as I go in to do smaller shapes, I can use my rounds or my angled brush. But I'll start with large, darker shapes with my flat brush. There's a branch that comes through the imagery, and there's a nice, deep, fun shadow area in here. Just going to go ahead and put that shadow area in. I'm actually mixing right on the paper. Squint down at your photo. To really be able to see what those shapes look like. I also see some area for blending in here. So as that shape begins to dry, you can actually blend in there. And this larger shape comes off. I think I might change to my smaller angled brush at this point because I see some nice small angled shapes that I can use. Let's move over some nice leaf shape here. We're not able to quite see the leaf shape because I'm just working on abstracted shadow shapes on the leaves. And later, we can go in and complete that form. This is another shadow shape. So this is an instance where I'm working with dark shadow shapes first, and later, I will go in and add the lighter, warmer colors over to unite these leaf shapes. Of the edge of a leaf there. Connect that. I see one more nice shape down in here. It's up. I need a little bit more of the Windsor yellow with the ultramarine blue. Allow it to be a little bit warmer. Send it down. just looking at, I'm not trying to draw the whole leaf, I'm just looking at abstracted patterns that are occurring with the different way that the light is playing across these leaves. Okay, I'll let that dry and then I'll go back in with some large warm colors. Okay, so while my darker shadow areas dry, I'm going to just go in and put in some of my lighter, warmer yellow-green areas. So I'm going to use the whole page. So we're going to go off the page, but I have a really nice leaf shape coming in here. I'm checking angles. And it's connecting nicely to this leaf in front of it. So my goal here is really just to put in this background leaf shape, and later, just looking at the shape, I can go over it with some details. And put in a big form. It goes all the way. So it's this warm yellow green that we can use to unify the entire painting. So here I have another big leaf shape. Comes in here and connects to a branch. I'm going to save that branch for later. I'll create a very neutral mixture just to subtly indicate the branch. This leaf shape here. Keeping in mind, as I do this leaf, I want to maintain that feeling that it is this a leaf that comes to a point. This is from a sycamore tree. So whenever you're working with nature, study the object that you're painting. Think about how many points are on the leaf, how many spikes to a leaf. When you're looking at bark, is it smooth or rough? And you really have to think about how are you going to create that texture. Be really careful where you may still have somewhat areas. I still have somewhat areas and it grabbed that. And here again, it's good to just be patient and wait for things to dry or come right up to the edge without. There, I can glaze over it and it's not. This is pretty dry up here, so I can allow this leaf to come completely off the edge. You can see we're just a really simple analogous color palette. You can get some really interesting things happening. Here again, because I'm using a light color, glazing over a darker color underneath it, I'm going to get some really nice transparencies. This is something that will work really well with your analogous color palette, because you're using this similar mixes, you're going to be able to maintain color harmony. And I just want to continue with that nice warm yellow green mix. Have a leaf over here. It comes down. Give it a little more of a leaf shape. Than I actually see in the photo. some leaf shapes coming down in here. Got a spike. Goes up. A really nice leaf shape coming off of this shadow. So it moves off and out, comes to a nice point. In this case, I'll have to use either my angled brush. I'm going to go ahead and use the round brush to get a more decisive tip to this. A really nice shape. Starts and comes up. Goes, and then I get another point to the leaf. It goes around that and connects to this point. Just maintaining that leaf shape. Curve here. And I can always fill it in. Still a wet above it, so I'm not going to get too close to that shadow area. And then I'm looking at my photo and checking to see what happens with this leaf. Spikes down. Here again, nice compositional movement downward, down, around, and then up. And that really gives us that nice leaf shape. I'm going to allow this to just dry because this part of the leaf here, the sunlight is going through. So you can look at different areas of your leaf where the sun may be going through, and you might want to just leave them a little lighter. I have another nice leaf coming off to this end where it does go off the page. Here I'll use my angled brush. Sticking with that same yellow-green color. Comes to a point right about here, goes up and connects that leaf, somewhat of a leaf shape, and comes down. I'll just fill this in. Have some blended areas that we can thin out if you don't want these blotches here. Just go over them. Or you have that wet on wet happening. You don't need this edge. Later we can go over it with the value. So I'm going to let this dry, and then I will go in with another layer in a few minutes. Okay, some of the painting has dried. I'm going to start back up at the top. Keeping in mind, this is an analogous color palette. So I'm using yellow, green, green, and blue green. So right now I'm putting in the green. I started with the shadow area. And with the shadow area, I was putting in the blue-green. And then then I jumped from the shadow area to the lighter tones, and I put in the yellow green, and now I'm going in with the green. So when you're when you're using the analogous color palette, you are using three colors that sit next to each other on the color wheel. And the reason we do we might choose a palette like that would be for color harmony. When you are using an analogous or monochromatic color palette, you can gently move off of that palette. And later in the demo, I'll show you how you can do that. I might go in with some mixtures of burnt umber just to indicate the branches. But the color palette will be predominantly analogous. So now I'm working around the branches. I'm just putting in some deep greens to indicate the leaf shapes. So I know that I'm painting leaves because I took the photo, but right now it's looking pretty abstract, so I might have to fake it a little and decide, okay, how can I make this look more like a leaf? I could give it a nice distinct spike that would help to define this as a leaf shape. Really the spikes on the edge of the leaf that really help to give us the sense that it is a leaf. Still a little wet there. Branch runs off over here. And we have a nice leaf shape up here. Right now I'm just trying to tie all of the leaves in together. While still keeping it simple, we do want to maintain some of our whites in here. Some nice leaf shapes in here as well. You don't have to follow your scene or your photo exactly. If you're moving along and you see where something else will work better than what you have in your photo, by all means, work with your composition. So I'm always stepping backward and forward. So these leaves are really nice. They branch off and are connected by a branch here. I may just decide to go in and put in that branch. So I'm gonna mix up some a bit of burnt umber with the ultramarine blue. See if I can't get just a color that's close to the palette. I may even add some green in there. I'm gonna mix some green and if we can't allow that branch shape to help us out a little bit. Branch coming through here. And push and let up. The branch comes down. Sweeps down. And then goes behind some of the leaves. And just a subtle indication of the branch will help to identify this as leaves on a tree. This ever so subtle indication of the branch going off the page and cutting through the composition is going to help. It can even be jagged. It doesn't have to be solid. Help to just give us some continuity in the piece. Now we can move off of that branch and allow this to be darker up here. A deeper branch color right up here, over in the shadow area. Still staying within that analogous color. Some twigs in here. Just putting that color over the deep green will help us. Might even help for some of our shadow shapes. Okay, so now I've got this deep green color. A little bit of that burnt umber mix. I'm going to try to bring these shadows from these leaves. Move your eye off to the page to the right. And mix up. I don't want to use too much of that, so I'm going to add more of my yellow. Wings are yellow into this. Creating indications of sunlight. This nice deep yellow color, keeping it pretty opaque. So I'm pulling some of that deep green with a little bit of burnt umber just to give me that sense of that bright sunlight hitting the leaves in some areas, leaving some areas a little bit more opaque and some areas transparent. Just allowing the sun to dance around these leaves. You see the color change happening in this leaf as well. I do want to maintain this transparent white, which later I'll go over. And we do have a deeper green. Here, and as I'm going in with this second shadow color here, this is a mixture of ultramarine blue, Windsor yellow, and I put very little bit of burnt sienna to tone that down to desaturate that color. And that's going to allow us to this leaf shape over here to the left to just feel more solid. This leaf shape, and then we have a spike on it. The leaf shape is here. And again, has a spike. And then it runs into another leaf. And this leaf runs off the page. Clean my brush and go in with that more saturated, highly saturated yellow with a little bit of that burnt umber. So this leaf here does have some bright sunlight shining through. So I do want to add that color in here very lightly, but I want it there. Make sure it's there. Some is saturated and some is not. Now I have this leaf has a really nice spike to the end of it. So I'll give it a spike. So this gives you an idea of how you can take an analogous color palette and start working with abstract shapes. And allow those abstract shapes turn into something representational. If you want it to be representational or non-representational, if you just want it to be expressive. So once you have your composition working the way you want it to work, all I'm going to do now is just go in with some detail areas. You can see how most of the painting is dry, and if I glaze over another color that's already in there, you can see how I can use glazing to unite the upper part of this tree branch. There are some leaves back here. I could just give that sense that there are leaves back here and create a spike, whether it's in the photo or not. Just create that leaf shape to indicate that there are more smaller leaves in the background. So for the rest of the painting, that's what I'll do, whether I look at my photo reference or whether I work with the composition. I'll go into unify shapes, unify shadows, and create shapes or shadow areas where it might be necessary. And I can see that close to that branch area, there is a need for some depth and shadow right up in this area. I can go in and just place some of that shadow in here. I can allow the shadow area allow some things to fall to the background and some things to come forward.